Hi, I'm Manoj. So today we'll be discussing about the Eastern Front of Second World War. I hope you have listened to my earlier lecture on Second World War, which gave an introduction about the war itself. Before we get into the actual operations of the war, a few important points. In 1939, Russia and Germany had signed a no aggression pact, which basically means I will not attack you and you will not attack me. It was generally called Hitler-Stalin Pact, although the more accurate name is Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact. This gave Hitler the freedom to focus entirely on the West Front in 1939 and 1940. After subjugating that part of the world, he turned to Russia. You can call it as a sucker punch or a dry gulch, as we say in the American Wild West, a totally unexpected hit at the Soviets. Now, to understand the Eastern Front, we have to consider a few important factors. One is the size and distances involved and corresponding logistics problems. You all know that Russia is the biggest country in the world, and the former USSR was even bigger. Many countries in the Asian part of USSR, like Uzbekistan, Azerbaijan, Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, etc., didn't participate in the war directly, in the sense that there was no war fought on their soil. But of course, there were soldiers enlisted and raw materials used, etc. On the western side of USSR, the countries like Belarus or Belarusia, Ukraine, and all were in the eye of the war. A lot of the war was fought in those republics. The size of the country and the distances involved indeed posed an important problem to both armies, initially to the German army and later to the Soviets. Because even if you win an important battle and seize a city, the next target is 500 miles, 1000 miles away. So there is a saying, an army marches on its stomach. Okay, in the past it obviously meant that the army and its horses should be fed. During Second World War it meant, of course, in addition to food, arms, ammunition, tanks, very importantly fuel, all of this need to keep pace with the army's progress. And this is not easy, because any army, when they retreat, they will try to destroy the roads, the bridges, the rail line, etc., and the engineers of the invading army has to quickly build them, and many a time it will not be easy. So this is an important factor to consider. Another one is geography. Russia is of course a very large country, and the biggest lake, or the deepest lake in the world, Lake Baikal, the longest river Ob, both of these are on the Siberian and the eastern side. They were never really part of the war. But a lot of other important rivers, the Bug River, the Dnieper, the Volga, Vistula, and Don. By the way, a side note, it is on the banks of the Don that Mikhail Sholokhov, the Nobel Prize winning Soviet novelist, wrote "And Quiet Flows the Don." For those who like large volume novels, is a very good one. It's a bit of a down-to-earth cousin of Tolstoy's War and Peace. Anyway, so all these important rivers and many marshes like the Pripyat Marsh, big lakes like Legoda Lakes, all of these act as important players in the war, or act as hindrances when an army is trying to progress. So building bridges quickly, trying to hold on to the bridgeheads while being exposed to enemy fire, all of these were important aspects in the war. The climate. Okay, everyone knows that Russian winters are severe. And in 1941, in the Battle of Moscow, which was the coldest winter in nearly 100 years in Moscow, it did play a factor. But generally, summer and winter are times when armies could operate. Some are for obvious reasons, and even in winter, once the surface freezes hard, the surface, the roads, the lakes, the rivers, all of them freezes hard, and movement of vehicles, including heavy tanks, was possible. It is the spring and the autumn which made movement very difficult. In late summer through autumn, there will be heavy rains, and this turned a lot of the roads and other areas into muds and bogs. It was very difficult to move in those times. And in springs, there is the thaw. Thaw is the melting of all the feet and meters of snow that falls during a Russian winter. It leads to heavy floods. No army can really move in those times. So really, most of the war was fought in summer and winter. For the first couple of years, in the summer, the Germans had a significant advantage. In fact, there used to be a term, summer Germans and winter Russians, because the few small successes that Russia got in the initial couple of years were in the winter times. Now, weapons. So, throughout the history of warfare, the weapons, the discovery of or invention of new or further enhancements of them played a very important role. If you look at, say, antiquity, in Egypt, a particular pharaoh and his empire was completely destroyed by an ancient tribe known as Hyksos. They were rather unknown till that point in history. The Egyptians, who were used to war on the Nile River as well as on land, were completely stumped by an animal which they had never seen. Its speed, the ability of man to control it, all of them completely stumped them. Can you guess what it is? It was a horse. The Egyptians had never seen it. So the use of horse by Hyksos in as war animals, in chariots, all of them turned the tide of that war. Similarly, iron swords, later steel swords, invention of gunpowder, guns, multi-loading guns, batteries of cannon, all of this influenced various wars. In American Civil War, the Gatling gun was invented. By the way, last year, in a nice Karthi movie named Kaidi, the Gatling gun is shown in the climax. In the First World War, the machine guns and the artillery guns were the main weapons that made a difference. So, Second World War being fought on land, water, above water, underwater, sea, on the skies, etc., a lot of weapons were used. But from torpedoes to bombs to all the way to atom bombs. However, the weapon that really defined Second World War is the tank. Tanks, of course, come in various forms, light, medium, and heavy. At the beginning of the war, armies had many light tanks, but as the war progressed, they were found to be no match for the heavier ones and were quickly discarded. So mainly the medium and the heavy tanks did the duty in the Second World War. The Germans called their tanks as panzers. So the Panzer III, Panzer IV medium tanks, the heavier ones named Tiger and Panther, these were the main tanks from the German side. The Russians started with T-26, but very quickly upgraded to T-34, which was a workhorse for them throughout the war. They also had heavier ones like the IS-1, IS-2, 3, etc. And Russians had a rather unique advantage in something called Katyusha rocket launcher. It was a good invention where on top of a truck, they could place multiple rockets up to 24, 32, there were different combinations, and launch them very, very quickly. Surprisingly, very recently, a few months back, Iran used the same Katyusha rocket launcher against American soldiers. The armies were formed in various combinations. The Germans arranged their armies as army groups, while the Russians arranged them as fronts. So a single army would be considered of multiple divisions. The divisions would each have 10 to 20,000 soldiers. Some of them would have mechanized corps, tanks, etc. And they were further grouped together as army groups. The army groups were reconstituted multiple times by Hitler as the war progressed. So they had different names, army groups A, B, C, Ukraine, Belarus, North, South, Center, etc. But for most of the war, the main ones were the army group North, Center, and South. And on the Russian side also, there were many fronts formed and changed as the war progressed, like the Volkov Front, the Leningrad Front, Steppe Front, Moscow Front, Stalingrad Front, etc. Overall, 13 plus million soldiers participated from the German side. Not all of them at the same time. This is the total number of soldiers enlisted. And on the Soviet side, it was 30 million plus. The German high command, military high command, was called as Wehrmacht, while the Soviet one was called Stavka. A side note, there was also a Far Eastern Front, a war between USSR and Japan, which was small but quite significant, and it was fought at the very end of Second World War in 1945. It led to a Soviet victory and to the liberation of the Koreas, Russia annexing the Sakhalin Islands, etc. The Sakhalin Island is an important strategic area in the sense that it is still supplying a significant amount of Soviet natural gas and oil. Anyway, we'll not focus on that. We'll focus on the main Eastern Front itself. It started in 1941, as I mentioned earlier, as sort of a sucker punch without any declaration of war. The operation was called Operation Barbarossa. It had the Germans, of course, as the main combatants, along with the armies of Romania and Finland supporting them. It started all with an all-out air attack, an unprecedented scale air attack, which destroyed a very large number of Soviet airplanes while they were still in hangars and in airfields. 3,100 Soviet aircraft were destroyed in the first couple of days of the air war, while the Germans themselves suffered only a loss of about 30-35. This tactics, by the way, was also used by Israel in their six-day war and other wars against Egypt and the Arabs, a preemptive strike destroying the opponent's air power. This gave, in the case of Second World War, complete air superiority for Luftwaffe and the Germans. So they could attack the Russian army formations with impunity and use tank destroyer and other aircraft without any real fear of retaliation. In the very early hours of the war, Stalin doubted whether the war was started on orders of Hitler. He was thinking that maybe this is just a trigger-happy general at the border initiating a small-scale skirmish. But soon he came to know, of course, that it was an all-out war. He made another mistake in asking the Soviet military units to counter-attack rather than defend. There were really no power position to do that, both because their command centers were destroyed and they were militarily inferior. This led to the Soviets exposing themselves and getting very quickly getting destroyed. A particular term that you will see over and over is pincer attacks. Pincers sort of refer to the two arms of a crab or of a scorpion. It basically means a military strategy where you go on the flanks of your opponent and merge at the back, thereby completing an encirclement. The enemy is within that circle, and once you have your tanks which cover the positions, the enemy can be destroyed slowly. This method was very successfully used by Germans in the beginning of the war and later by the Soviets too. So in the course of action, the army group north broke out towards Leningrad. Leningrad was the name used for St. Petersburg, and St. Petersburg was the second most important city in USSR. And the army group center attacked towards Vilnius, Minsk, Smolensk. These are in Belarus, with of course their main target, eventual target being Moscow. And the army group south attacked towards Kiev in Ukraine, and later towards Stalingrad. Initially, in the initial days of war, there was very significant progress. The German army broke through the Soviet defenses, encircled and killed or captured hundreds of thousands of soldiers. The soldiers captured were typically sent to hard labor camps, and very few of them survived through the length of the war. Now, a bit of focus on the siege of Leningrad. As I mentioned, the army group north moved towards it, and Finland attacked from the north. It led to an almost encirclement, not complete, because on one side of Leningrad is the very huge Lake Ladoga. But it led to a siege of Leningrad. Hitler's policy was not to take prisoners at Leningrad. He wanted to starve the population into non-existence or submission. The siege of Leningrad lasted for close to 3 years. The Russians showed incredible valor in surviving through that period. In between, food was so scarce that there were reports of cannibalism. About 1.5 million people died of starvation. Even then, the factory workers, there were schoolboy units which fought to resist. The only way the Russians could provide supplies to Leningrad for a long period was over Lake Ladoga. Now, in summer, through ships, the shipment was very limited. In winter, there is a long period when the lake freezes over. Just like how there are ice road truckers in Canada now, Lake Ladoga had trucks, both trucks and horse wagons, carrying food and armaments on top of the frozen ice of the lake. This was called the Road of Life. Even with that, the rations were so small, so pathetic, that for a fighting soldier, it was about 2.5 pieces of bread per day. And for a non-fighting civilian, it was nearly half of that. Still, they fought, survived the siege, and nearly 3 years later, the siege was lifted, first partially by opening a small corridor, and later fully when the tide of the war turned. After the significant initial successes in the war, Hitler and the Wehrmacht had to decide between a direct attack towards Moscow or focusing their attention on the industrial center of Kharkov and the oil of the Caucasus. Hitler chose for the latter. So the army was sent to conquer Kharkov, the whole of Ukraine, which is considered as the wheat basket of USSR, and the oil fields of the Caucasus. It was a partial success. Kharkov and the whole of Ukraine was captured, but the oil fields themselves were not captured because they were quite far, and operating in the mountains of Caucasus was very difficult. So after a couple of months on that, the focus was put back on the attack towards Moscow. So the Wehrmacht restarted the drive towards Moscow in October 1941. The Russians had gotten a couple of months to upgrade their defenses. They tried to build a three-layer defensive ring. However, as earlier, the tanks of German army punched through the initial defensive lines with ease. But this being Moscow, the Russians were better prepared. They had brought in a lot of reserves from Far East. Also, the attack plans called for a pincer move again, one to the north and one to the south of Moscow. Throughout this period, Stalin publicly remained in Moscow attending meetings and generally showing that courage to the people. Moreover, Russia conducted its only military parade during this time. Every year, there used to be a victory parade in Moscow in Red Square to commemorate the October Revolution. This was done under the threat of imminent German invasion in 1941 in Moscow. It was a supreme act of political theater. Stalin addressed the crowds. Many of the soldiers took part in the march and immediately went to the front lines. Imagine the soldiers participating in the Indian Republic Day parade, waving to their families and immediately going to battle on the border. This was like that. There was very heavy winter in 1941. It was the coldest winter in 20th century. This significantly slowed down the progress of German tanks. Most of the roads became almost impossible to travel on. The Russians, who were better equipped to deal with the winter, could make very effective defensive operations. So the German army marched on till about 20 kilometers from the capital of Russia. There they halted. They were forced to stop. After a few weeks of rather stalemate, Russia launched counterattacks in early January 1942. This drove back the front a few 50-60 kilometers away from Moscow and raised and removed the immediate threat to Russian capital. Of course, the battles still continued in some strategic points in that front, mainly in the Rzhev sector. There was so much man and material thrown into that war and so much loss of life that it came to be known as the Rzhev meat grinder. And the war continued for the next year and a half. Still, with the Russian counteroffensive stabilizing, the main operations of 1941 summer and winter came to a close. Then, as I mentioned earlier, the thaw of period of spring intervened, and the next big operations would start in the summer. This mainly involved the Russian, the German army group center, again attacking towards the Caucasus and another towards Stalingrad. The attack towards Caucasus again gained initial traction. It even led to a symbolic victory of the Germans raising their flag on top of the tallest mount in Europe, in the Caucasus. But they couldn't really get over the mountains and get to Baku or Grozny, which are the main oil fields. They are now in Azerbaijan. The focus was more towards Stalingrad. Now, Stalingrad is the city which at that point held the name of Stalin. The Battle of Stalingrad is rightly considered by historians to be the turning point of Second World War. It was a war involving the maximum number of soldiers and the maximum casualties. The casualties was in excess of 2 million from both sides. It was led by Paulus's 6th Army and Hermann Hoth's 4th Panzer Army from the German side. The battle plan called for crossing two major rivers, the Dnieper and Volga, and capturing Stalingrad. The distance between Volga and Dnieper at that point is only about 60 kilometers or so. And Stalingrad is right on the banks of Volga. Stalingrad was at that point named after Stalin, so it had significant political importance. And it was also a very important factory city for Russia. So Hitler wanted to capture it at any cost. Now Stalingrad is called Volgograd, by the way. As in the previous summer, the attack initially gained pace. Many small cities in between were captured by the Germans quickly, and it expanded towards Stalingrad after capturing Voronezh. The Russians had to rush in supplies. In fact, Stalin issued an order, not a step back. Basically, it meant that if you try to flee, if a soldier tries to withdraw, he will be shot by his own colleagues. Mostly people consider it cruel. However, at that point, it was considered necessary to steel the resolve of the soldiers in the front. The Germans attacked and broke into the Stalingrad city. But the fighting was very, very intense. They had to fight for each building, for each piece of rubble, so to speak. The Russians adopted a strategy of hugging the Germans. Basically, it meant their soldiers would occupy buildings as close as possible to the German lines. So, it was not easy for the Germans to call in air attack and bomb the area for fear of bombing their own positions. There was fierce fighting for various important points like the railway station, the grain storage area, the tractor factory, etc. The Germans made advances, but little by little at the cost of very heavy loss of life. Still, in 2 months into the battle, the German army occupied 80 to 90% of Stalingrad. That is when, for the first time in Second World War, the Russians devised and executed a pincer movement. Basically, they decided to attack along the flanks of the German army, both on the north and the south, and outflank the Germans and capture them in a trap. The flanks of the German army were held by their allies, mainly the Romanians, and they were relatively weaker. So the Russian fronts, led by Watutin, attacked from the north and the south, and over a period of a week or so, broke through the Romanian lines and met, thereby encircling Polis's 6th Army. Immediately after the encirclement, the Russian army took a twice defensive posture, basically defending against external attacks trying to free the army and an internal one from the trapped army. This Russian operation, the encirclement of 6th Army, was codenamed Operation Uranus. Hitler asked the 6th Army to stay put and asked Luftwaffe to supply it by air. They tried, but it was impossible to supply an army that large, purely through air. He then asked Field Marshal von Manstein to drive a wedge on the Russian forces and to provide a way for the German army to escape. This operation, codenamed Winterstorm, started well but soon bogged down as Russia poured in wave after wave of tank armies and men into the battle. There were heavy loss on both sides, but after many days of grueling battle, the Germans were driven back to their original positions. And with that, the fate of Paulus's 6th Army in Stalingrad was sealed. Over the next few weeks, through close and bloody battle, Russian forces split the pockets of German resistance. Hitler never allowed the army to surrender. But after a few weeks of fighting without enough food and ammunition, Paulus and the army surrendered in late January 1943. This battle, the Battle of Stalingrad, was truly the turning point of Second World War. For the first time, the Russians inflicted a very severe defeat on the Wehrmacht. It was very demoralizing for the Germans, and similarly very encouraging for not only Russians but also all of the Allies, including the British, Americans, etc. Hitler had also later remarked to his advisors that he lost the war at Stalingrad. Although there were a few minor actions like Operation Little Saturn, effectively with Stalingrad, the action of 1942 summer and winter finished. The next major battle was in the summer of 1943, and it began with the Battle of Kursk. This was the heaviest mechanized battle in the history of the world. It had the maximum number of tanks and artillery participating in a single battle. About 8,000 tanks, 5,000 from Russian side and 3,000 from German side, participated in it. In comparison, if you look at the number of tanks that, say, India and China together has now, although no country exactly specifies how many arms and ammunition they have, it's believed to be about 8,000 tanks. That much was spent or participated in a single action in the Battle of Kursk. So at the end of 1942 actions, there was a bulge or a salient around the city of Kursk. It is like a bell curve drawn sideways. The Russian forces were inside that bulge, while the German forces were on two sides. So it was pretty appetizing for the Germans to attempt their favorite pincer attack. If they could attack from the north and the south and pinch off the salient, a huge Russian army will be trapped. But the Russians could also easily guess this. Any general looking at the map could guess that this is where the next German attack would come. Many in the Russian army wanted to counterattack first, but the wise advice of Marshal Shukov prevailed. He basically wanted the German spearhead to butt its head against Russian defenses, be exhausted, and only after that to start a Russian counterattack. So two fronts, led by Rokossovsky and Watutin, were tasked with preparing the defenses. The defenses were very exhaustive. Three lines of defenses of anti-tank ditches, guns, minefield, all were built. There were about 3,000 mines per kilometer in that area. The German attack was led by Field Marshal von Kluge's Army Group Center, attacking from the north of the Kursk salient, and Field Marshal von Manstein's Army Group South, attacking from the southern side. The attack itself was postponed by Hitler by a couple of months to get in more divisions of the Panther tank, the heavy Tiger tanks, and the Elephant tank destroyers. The attack started reasonably well, but for the first time in the whole of Second World War, a German mechanized attack was stopped before it could achieve even the initial targets. Within 1 or 2 days, the width of the front was skewed by the Soviets from about 30 miles to just 5. And the progress was very slow and very bloody. This, as I mentioned earlier, involved some of the heaviest tank battles ever recorded in history. After that, the German spearhead was stopped. The Russians immediately poured in reserves from their steppe front and started counter-attacking. This quickly made the positions of the German army groups untenable, especially along the Oral Salient, and they had to withdraw. So within a few weeks, the whole of the attempt of Battle of Kursk, which was codenamed Citadel by the Wehrmacht, was stopped. The armies were back in their starting positions. But the Soviets, now having an upper hand, did not stop there. They immediately pushed to move the front out by a few hundred kilometers. And they were successful in that. So with that, the major operations of the summer of 1943 finished. The next major operations started in the winter time of 1943, the autumn and winter. This started with the Battle of Smolensk, which freed the Smolensk area of the German forces. And then the battle moved on to the Dnieper area. Dnieper is, as I mentioned, one of the most important and largest rivers. And it was primarily around the Dnieper, the lower Dnieper offensive and the Dnieper Carpathian offensive, which was aimed at clearing Ukraine of German forces. It happened on the northern side of Sea of Azov and Black Sea. And the attack on Dnieper was really tough for the Red Army, because the banks on the west side of the river are naturally at a higher elevation. So attacking from the east, going against the height of the banks, was a very difficult and partially suicidal mission. But by then, the Russian army had both acquired the military might and the planning skills to plan and execute such an operation. Still, it was a very costly battle in terms of the number of people died, etc. But over the course of the winter and early spring of 1943-44, they drew back the Germans from that side of Soviet Union into Romania. This had another important political impact also, because once the war reached their own borders, Romania very quickly changed sides from Axis to Allies, and they became a part of the Allied alliance and started fighting against the Germans in their own area. The border and the line of control between USSR and Germany was racing eastwards in 1941. In 1942, despite many heavy battles, the borders changed only in a limited fashion. The border started moving westwards in 1943, and it became a race over 44 and 45. So at the end of the combat operations of 43, with the Dnieper operation, the Battle of Smolensk, and the Carpathian offensive, the borders had reached already into Romania. And it also cut off the German army group in Crimean Peninsula. Now, Crimea was in news recently also, when Putin annexed it from Ukraine a couple of years back. Russia being the largest country in the world, it was a bit of a surprise for a group of people why they wanted to acquire another few thousand square kilometers. But one important aspect about Russian geography is that it lacks a lot of old weather ports. So a lot of Russian coastline is in the Siberian region, which gets clogged with snow and ice through half of the year. On the far east, they do have some ports, but then it's pretty far from all the industrial parts of Russia. Crimea offers an entry into Black Sea. The important ports like Sevastopol are in Crimea. So even now, it's an important area for Russia to acquire. And most of Crimeans anyway are Russians. Now, back to the war. So with Crimea cut off, Germans were still confident of supplying it through various ports from Romania and otherwise. In the beginning of 1944, there was another operation, a rather limited one, but an operation through Sea of Azov to acquire two bridgeheads or two landing points in Crimea. One of them was repelled after very heavy fighting by the Germans, but the second one was established and expanded. And this became a launch point for the attack or the offensive that freed Crimea. At the end of that war, the Germans had to hastily move a lot of arms and armaments from Sevastopol through sea. And it, of course, suffered a lot of casualties, and they had to let go of most of their heavy equipment. So through the offensive of the Red Army, an important decision that Hitler took was to call a lot of areas, assign a lot of areas as fortified areas. By that, he meant that these areas, once designated as fortified areas, should be defended to the last man. And the army was not allowed to withdraw without explicit consent of the Führer. This had both pros and cons. It had the pros in the sense that the army, once knew that they had no chance of withdrawal, fought with their backs to the wall and caused heavy casualties on the advancing Russians. On the other hand, this led to a lot of key armies and their armaments and tanks, etc., getting caught in pincer moves of the Soviets and eventually getting destroyed. So in 1944, the stage was set for one of the biggest actions of Second World War, which was called Operation Bagration by the Russians. Bagration was the name of a prince who fought valiantly against Napoleon a couple of centuries earlier. Bagration was the first instance where the Soviets very successfully integrated two aspects of their military doctrine and one practical aspect. The practical aspect was very close coordination with the partisans or the communist followers who were in the occupied territories. This led to what was called the rail war. The partisans damaged a lot of rail lines and stations en route and caused a logistical nightmare to Wehrmacht. The two theories or the two aspects of military doctrine were camouflage and deep operations. By camouflage, what they meant was to indicate that the attack will be in some other sector while they intended to attack in Belorussia. Most of the German intelligence gathered indicated that the next big offensive during 1944 summer will happen in the Ukraine region. So the Wehrmacht in fact moved some panzer armies, tank armies towards south. This was the success of the Russian deception. The last element, the deep strike or Soviet deep operations, meant that while a front or the spearhead of the army will cause a breakthrough. There will be many reserves, unutilized reserves kept, especially tank armies, which can then be quickly inserted into the gap and used that to strike deep within the strategic reserve of the enemy. This primarily was possible because of the significant difference in strength the Russians could muster at that point. Against the army group center, which had about, the army group center had about 0.9 million soldiers and 2000 odd artillery tanks and about 1000 airplanes. Against this, the Russians could field double the number of people and almost 8 times the number of tanks, artillery and airplanes. This was a massive difference. The operation itself was conducted over multiple phases, and the Russians kept enlarging their objectives as they won easy victories. It started with the Vitebsk offensive, then rolled into Mogilev, Bobrysk, and soon it reached Minsk. Minsk is the capital of Belarus or Belarusia, and there, because of the Hitler's policy of fortified place, there was an army kept to guard that, and it was encircled and destroyed over the course of a few days. Then the Russian offensive juggernaut rolled on to Vilnius, which is the capital of Lithuania, and even further into Poland. The Marshal of the USSR is the highest military position in USSR. In addition to Grigory Shukhov, many others like Ivan Konev, Gogorov, Malinovsky and Rokossovsky all received this title in the second half of World War II. This is similar to the Field Marshal title in the Indian Army. It is a 5-star general title. In India, for example, only 2 people have ever been awarded that. That is, of course, Sam Manekshaw and Kariyappa, Field Marshal Kariyappa. These are awarded only during a war. Normally, only up to 4-star generals will be present in an army. And similar to this, the corresponding title in Indian Air Force is Marshal of the Indian Air Force. And there has only been one person, Arjun Singh, who has been the Marshal of Indian Air Force. Now, back to the war, and the Russian summer of successes continued in 1944. After Operation Bagration, the next major offensive was the Lvov-Sandomierz offensive. This cleared the western Ukraine of German forces, and also Russia got a foothold in eastern Poland and Romania. They reached up to the Vistula River. This was also a major offensive led by Konev. Of course, smaller in size compared to Operation Bagration, still involving more than 1 million soldiers. As part of this, couple of German Panzer armies were surrounded in Brody and annihilated. Once Russians reached Vistula, Warsaw, which is not far from there, there was a popular uprising against the German occupiers. Historians term it a bit suspicious that the Red Army did not rush to their aid. The Russians had the excuse of their supply lines being not in order, etc. Anyway, they did not intervene, and the Germans mercilessly crushed the Warsaw uprising. There are also theories which say that the people who made the revolt were not left enough, were not communist enough, and that's why Stalin ignored them. Anyway, the battle continued with the Battle of Romania. In this, the Red Armies attacked Romania from northeast through the area of Moldova, and again it was another big success for the Red Army. The Battle of Romania also had a couple of important political impacts. Seeing the turn in the wind, the change of wind, Romania changed sides, exited the Axis powers and surrendered to the Russians and declared war on Germany. This was led by the King of Romania, who kicked out the Prime Minister Andronescu. Similarly, seeing the success of the Red Army, Bulgaria also withdrew from the Axis and sort of invited the Soviet forces into their land. Now, there was a pretty big war, Battle of Debrecen, which followed, where the Russians fought against the German and Hungarian forces, since Hungary still was with the Axis, and this led to the German army being removed from the Debrecen area. Meanwhile, in the north, north of St. Petersburg or Leningrad, there was another engagement between the Soviets and the Finnish army. Remember, Finland was also an ally of Germany. Here, the Russians made good progress up to a point in the Karelian Isthmus, but dogged defense by the Finnish, and because Red Army had bigger objectives elsewhere, this was stopped after a while. Still, it forced the Finnish to accept Russian terms of surrender within a few months. If you look at the map of Eastern Europe, the most straightforward route from the erstwhile USSR to Germany is through Poland. But when major armies move, one of their biggest threats or most important aspects is to protect their flanks so that there are no enemy attacks to the flanks. This is achieved either by removing the threats on the flanks or by always putting strong armies to defend the sites, the flanks. So in the case of USSR, they decided to eliminate the threat on the northern flank. So Army Group North of the German army was occupying the Baltic states like Latvia, Lithuania and Estonia. So in the autumn of 1944, the Red Army launched a Baltic offensive to clear the German army from these regions. Now, this had many offensives towards Riga, Tallinn. Tallinn is the capital of Lithuania Estonia. And there were separate actions against the Army Group North in those areas. Eventually, German Army Group North was cut off in Courland Peninsula. Now, from the Courland Peninsula, that army could have been evacuated through the Baltic Sea to Germany. And many of the generals advised Hitler to do that. But by then, Hitler had become increasingly delusional. He wanted to keep the army in Courland as a launch pad for future attacks into Russia. So he refused to move the army back to Germany. So effectively, the German Army Group North in Courland was cut off from all action, since they were surrounded by the Russian army and they lived there in relative peace till the end of the war. Thus, Germany lost a reasonably sized army group which could have aided them in the defense of Germany and Battle of Berlin. The next set of major targets for Soviet Russia in the fall of 1944 were Belgrade and Budapest. Belgrade, as you know, is the capital of Serbia. But during Second World War, it was the capital of Yugoslavia. Now, after Red Army success in Romania, Bulgaria had changed sides, as I mentioned earlier. So the Belgrade offensive was led by Red Army along with Bulgarian army, and they had pretty good assistance from a well-organized Yugoslav partisan group. So the northern part of the offensive was led a lot by the Bulgarian army and Yugoslav partisans, while on the southern side, it was led by Soviet Red Army. There was a bit of a race towards Blue Line. It was and intended fortifications on the southern slope of the Carpathian Mountains, and also aligning with a gorge or a canyon in the Danube called Iron Gates. The Iron Gates was, of course, much smaller than Grand Canyon, but bigger than, say, Gandikota in Andhra Pradesh. By the way, Gandikota is really beautiful and worth a visit. Now, the Russian lead elements managed to reach the Iron Gates first, but the German mountain armies retaliated, and there were many change of hands of that area. But eventually, the Russian 3rd Belorussian Front could put in more units and quell, defeat the resistance of the German army there. Eventually, it led to the splitting of the German army into multiple groups and their subsequent defeat. The Budapest offensive, in contrast, was a much more tougher and longer exercise spanning over 4 months. This was partially due to the terrain. Budapest is a twin city, split by Danube into as Buda and Pest. Pest is more or less flat area, while Buda is very hilly. And this is very suitable for a well-entrenched defense. It took the Russians many months even to get a foothold in Buda. Eventually, only after the Belorussian front, which was fighting in Belgrade, successfully finished their operation and joined the Budapest offensive, Russians could really make headway. So eventually, only in early February, Budapest could be freed of German occupation. After conquering Budapest and Belgrade, the Red Army focused on Poland again and an entry into Germany itself. This was mainly achieved by the Vistula Oder offensive. Vistula and Oder both are rivers. Vistula is the longest river in Poland. Oder is also a long and major river, and it forms the boundary between Poland and Germany. This attack was led by two major Russian fronts, led by Marshal Grigory Shukhov and Marshal Ivan Konev. This offensive was pretty quick because the Russians amassed an extraordinary huge artillery range barrage for this offensive. So most of the German defenses were destroyed in the initial hours itself from artillery bombardment as well as air bombardment. They moved pretty quickly to Oder River, and once they crossed it, they stopped. En route, many Nazi concentration camps were liberated by the Russians, and the Russians invited the world press to come and see the horrors of the concentration camps. This was the first time the world was really seeing the concentration camps. Once the Germans realized that this is extremely bad publicity, they ordered the other concentration camps in that area to be closed and marched the Jews as well as prisoners of war in these camps westwards, away from the advancing Red Army. This is known as Death March, since hundreds of thousands of members of the concentration camps, including Jews and prisoners of war, died in such a long trek without enough food, water, and in sub-zero climate. Once the Russians reached the German borders, Stalin ordered a halt. He had two options: try to attack Berlin directly — Berlin was only 70 kilometers from the border — or try to conquer more parts of Eastern Europe. He chose to do the latter. This was because of the happenings on the Western Front of the war. After the Normandy landings on D-Day in June 1944, the Allied forces of the USA, UK, Canada, France, etc. were advancing from the western side and occupying many parts of Europe. So for any post-war negotiations, Stalin decided that he wanted to get control of as much of the territory as possible. So rather than directly attacking Berlin, he decided to conquer more areas. So many offensives were executed as part of this, like the offensive into West Prussia, where Kohlberg, Danzig, fortified area, etc. were captured. An attack into East Prussia, where Königsberg was captured. This was a pretty heavy offensive, because Königsberg was a very well defended city. And it took the Russians many weeks and a lot of losses before they could acquire that. This was followed by the Vienna offensive. This was to invade and conquer Vienna and most of Austria. This battle was characterized also by fierce urban combat and the well-entrenched German panzer armies held off the Russians for a few weeks before the Russians could subdue and fully control Vienna. This later led to a better negotiating position for Stalin at the end of the war. The last major offensive the Germans could muster in Second World War was named Operation Spring Awakening in the March 1945 period. This was done near Lake Balaton. This area was of great strategic interest, because this was the last oil fields that the Wehrmacht controlled at that point in the war. So Hitler threw in his best panzer armies, fielding the heavy new Tiger II tanks, and their order was to attack from Lake Balaton through to Danube River. But at that time, the Red Army had overwhelming numbers in their favor. Although the Germans made some initial progress, their armies were stopped within a week. And once the Soviets counterattacked in strength, the German armies had to turn tail and rush back to Germany. Now, the field was set for the last major actions in Europe in Second World War, mainly the Battle of Berlin. This took place in April-May 1945. The Russians employed three major fronts. The first Belarusian front led by Marshal Grigory Shukov, first Ukrainian front led by Ivan Konev, and also the second Belarusian front led by Rokossovsky for the Battle of Berlin. The aim also was to push the joining or merger with their Western allies as west as possible. Both sides assumed correctly that whichever area is controlled by an army will mostly remain in that army's hands after the end of the war. So Stalin wanted to move as west as possible as part of Battle of Berlin and subsequent actions. So the attack on Berlin was commenced in April on a wide front. Initially, they had to get over the Oder River, and there was a pretty pitched fighting in that area, in the Oder Neis River area. Once the Russians broke through that, there was very little resistance till the Berlin suburbs. The Russians encircled Berlin and started a heavy bombardment which lasted till the end of the war. At the end of April, Hitler married Eva and committed suicide on 30th. The battle still continued for a few more days till the German army surrendered on 9th May. However, this was not the complete end of Second World War in Europe. the Germans and Nazis considered Czechoslovakia as kindred brethren, and they had, even before the Battle of Berlin, had placed reasonably strong army group Sender and army group Ostmark in Czechoslovakia, hoping that they can surrender to the Western Allies and in secret continue the Nazi movement. But the Red Army continued their offensive after the success of the Battle of Berlin into Prague, which was the capital of Czechoslovakia. This operation happened in May itself, within a few days of Battle of Berlin. And although there was an attempt by the Germans to move westwards and surrender to the UK-USA allies, the Russian encirclement mostly prevented it. And by 11th of May, Prague was also captured. The last shots were fired in Europe, and the Second World War, the biggest and bloodiest war world has ever seen, was over in Europe. Of course, the actions continued in Pacific between the US and Japan, and also, as I mentioned earlier, there was the Russian Northeast battle against the Japanese for areas of Sakhalin Island, North and South Korea, etc. But the Second World War ultimately was decided in Europe, and it was decided on the Eastern Front. That was decisively over in the May of 1945. Thank you.